So first, a couple housekeeping things. I'm really hoping this will be a conversation as opposed to a straight presentation. So if you want to participate in the conversation, it'll make it easier for me to hear you if you move up. I've got the mic, I've got the advantage. So if you don't want to participate, that's fine. And if I understand that there are vendors and things, so feel free to come and go. It's not going to bother me. I just want you to enjoy what we can. As Bob mentioned, I'm from Bloomfield. Bloomfield is, Bloomfield, what's that? It's a little town in southeast Iowa. We're about 15 miles from Missouri, and we are about 70 miles from Illinois. And I'd never been to Oregon before. And I got to tell you, I tell people, where are you going this weekend? Oh, I'm going to Oregon. Illinois. You know?
It's, Washington, Illinois.
Is it far, or is it next door?
It's at least 100 miles.
Okay. All right. Well, so Oregon and Bloomfield have some similarities. Bloomfield is about 2,600 people, and I think I saw on the sign that you're at, what, 3,800? Something like that. Okay. Bloomfield is at the junction of Highway 2 and 63. I think you're at the junction of Highway 2 and 64, right? You've got gray squirrels. We've got red squirrels. We're the county seat. Our county seat is limestone, and the buildings around are red brick. And it looks like a lot of your buildings are limestone and your county courthouse is red brick. So anyway, I think we have some things in common. Here's the direction I'm going to go today. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about Bloomfield first, then I'm going to give you a little history of the community and the area, and then I'm going to walk you through the story of how we ended up talking about energy independence. And what I'd like is, at any point along the way, throw up your hands, interrupt, have a conversation, that's okay, because just wandering around here, I'm amazed at the knowledge that I've already run into today. So I'm sure there are many things that you know about that I'm unaware of, and I'm here to learn as well as to share our story. There's one other thing. I need a timekeeper. Is anybody willing to be my official timekeeper?
Yeah, I will.
Okay, so just...
She's very good. She gets me up in the morning.
All right. Very good. Thank you. And then there's one other thing. Anybody ever see the movie Blues Brothers? All right. So I figured Illinois, right? You've seen it. So if you wander around the parking lot, we're a brand new department. I'm the energy efficiency director for the city of Bloomfield. I've been on the job about 4 months. And so I get the leftovers. I had to go take the chairs that nobody else wanted, take the desks that nobody else wanted. And if you wander around the parking lot, you'll see a black and white. That's because it's the police didn't want it anymore, right? And so my wife, when she knew I was going to Illinois, she's like, if you go past the sign with Joliet, you got to get a picture. So, and she gave me sunglasses to match, you know? I told her there is absolutely no way I'm tattooing my name on my knuckles. Yeah. Anyway, so Bloomfield, the southern tier of counties in Iowa are, they're unique. So Iowa's kind of known as a farming state, grow a lot of grain, a lot of cattle, a lot of hogs. And down in our neck of the woods, the hills, it's hillier, we've got more timber. Frankly, we're just not as wealthy as once you get one tier of states up. Lots of jokes about the southern tier of states. There's about 8,600 people in our county, which is, in Iowa, all the counties are pretty much 25 miles by 25 miles square. And about half of our people in the community are low income, low to moderate income. So we've been struggling. Wasn't always that way, but it's been that way for about the past 25 years or so, maybe a little longer, actually since 1983, and we'll get to that. But you need to understand a little bit about who we are to understand why we took on this task of going towards energy independence. Bloomfield's in that location where when the pioneers were coming west, they crossed the Mississippi, then they crossed the Des Moines River, and then they started to hit the prairie. And they tell me there's a big prairie around here, right? About 4,600 acres or something like that. Have any of you been on it? The grass gets tall, right? And can you imagine trying to take and trailblaze across the prairie? It'd be hard work. So Davis County is the dropout place. So you're heading west, you see the prairie, and you say, oh my gosh, I can't do it. I'm staying here. So that's a lot of our heritage, right? In 1883, well, let me back up. I'm going to pull up my notes here. Give me just one moment. In 1883, a gentleman wrote a book called The Rise and Progress of Civilization in the Hairy Nation. And when he's talking about the Hairy Nation, he's talking about Bloomfield in Davis County. And we got a reputation for being the Hairy Nation because visitors would come to our community, look at how hairy and we were wearing buckskins, and they go back and tell everybody avoid that place. And we kind of got a reputation. A little more background. Iowa was shifting in territories. It was part of the Louisiana Purchase. It was in the Wisconsin Territory. Then it was in the Illinois Territory. Anyway, it shifted around. But in 1838, it became a state. In 1839, there was this thing called the Honey War. And the Honey War was that, remember that bottom tier of counties I told you about? They're a little different. Well, and these guys were, again, the dropouts. When the tax collector came down from Des Moines, or in that time it was Burlington was the capital of the territory, tax collector came, all the people in that bottom row of state counties would say, you know, we're actually part of Missouri. You can't collect. And believe it or not, when the Missouri tax collector came, where do you think they were from, right? And it got bad enough that this sheriff from Missouri decided, I'm going to collect. So he rode up into what is now Iowa, and he cut down three trees to take the honey and said, if you won't pay your taxes, I'm taking the honey and I'm out of here. But he was arrested. And then it actually got to the point where there were militia on both sides of the border getting ready to come in, and somebody stopped it. And today we're part of Iowa, and most of us pay our taxes. But we've always had a bit of there were brawlers and fighters and a bit independent, I guess. But we've also been, we don't take ourselves too seriously either. When they decided to form the county seat, three gentlemen got together, three supervisors, they had to decide what the name of the county would be. One person, one supervisor said it should be Davis. Another one said it should be Jefferson. And the third person said it should be Bloomfield. So in our typical fashion, we threw all the names in a hat and pulled one out, and today we're Bloomfield and probably will be for a long time. So that's kind of one side of us, right? But if you come to Davis County, you'll see our courthouse is beautiful. I mean, every day somebody stops to take a picture. It was built in 1877 for about $45,000. They say it's a French Renaissance architecture. I'm not an architect, I don't know, but it truly is a beautiful sight. I don't know who had the vision at that time. You know, you don't think of these rough and tumble guys saying, hey, let's build this beautiful monument to government, I guess. Especially when they weren't wanting to pay their taxes, right? That doesn't make sense. So I bring that up because it's a model. So they had the vision, they had the dedication to do something that at that time was a great thing. And sometimes we get away from that in rural Iowa. We think, you know, we're the also runs. They're the ones nobody thinks about. The great ideas, you don't hear people talking about the great ideas coming out of rural places anymore. At one time, yes, but it's not common. Well, part of that story began to change for us in terms of the downturn. We had a strong rural heritage. We were innovative. And at one time, we were the wool capital of the United States, they say. Had a lot of sheep. But in 1983, the Exchange Bank in Bloomfield folded. It was one of the very first banks to fold in the farm crisis, and it just gutted the town. I mean, if you were, I'm sorry, I'm a hand talker, so the microphone might move, so if I get away, please just bring it back. It took capital out of our community. It took brain power out of our community. If you grew up in the 80s and 90s and you graduated from high school, what do you think your parents said? Leave. You can't do anything here. It's not possible to be successful here. It's taken a long time to try to change that. I think we're just starting to get there. Mid-90s, I think our Main Street organization is 20 years old this year. The mid-90s, we're about 12 years past that bank failure. Businesses have closed, buildings are deteriorating. A small group of people said, we've got to do something. And they formed a Main Street organization. Now, Main Street is a national organization focused on economic recovery and historic preservation of your buildings. And one of the first things that this group did was get our entire square on the National Register of Historic Places. And what that did, it changed attitudes, right? It doesn't seem like it should make a difference, but when you name something like that, people say, oh, we've got something, you know? And they didn't know, nothing was different other than the name, right? And one of the things that I hope to repeat throughout this conversation is that it's important to listen. You have to have the conversations, you have to listen, and I don't mean listen to the point where I hear what you're saying, but listen to the point where I appreciate what you're saying. And one of the things that happened with that National Historic Register on the square, people began to appreciate the town in a different way. That was 20 years ago, and we've come a long ways, and we've got a long ways to go. In 2004, a group of people said, it's about time we did something about our streets and sidewalks. And so they brought in some landscape architects from Iowa State University. Trees forever came down, and we spent a year going through a visioning process. We had meeting after meeting after meeting with different community members. We talked to it was a lot of conversations, a lot of input. And we spent a full year figuring out what would be the plan for our square. Beautiful drawings, great cost estimates. We unveiled it at a big public meeting, brought in the county supervisors, brought in the city council members. I think there were about 100 people there, which in our town, that's a pretty good turnout. And we get through it all, and my 7-year-old daughter was there. And I was helping with the presentation, doing questions and answers, and she says, yeah, but Dad, are we actually going to do it? And I said, of course. Well, it's still not done. And I'll tell you why. After we did that presentation, the next week we were going in front of the city council to ask them to fund it. And we get up there. We do the full presentation. We'd talk to council members. We were sure this was going to pass. It was a 30-second discussion. They denied it. Boom, done. And it just blew us away. You know, we'd worked hard. We'd listened, right? That's what I tell you. You got to listen. Well, what we hadn't taken into account was in between that time that we did our public presentation and the time that we went to the city council, one of the buildings on the square fell down. It had enough, right? And so I didn't know what to do. My partner in crime was cussing and screaming and didn't know what to, you know, what do we do? These guys said they were on board, and then they denied it. And if you've ever been in front of public boards, you know sometimes it's unpredictable. I didn't know what to do. But I knew one of the guys and I on the city council, and I'm not promoting this tactic, but it worked for this. I called up a friend of his and I said, what's his favorite kind of beer? And I picked up a 6-pack and I went out to his mechanic shop and we sat and we had a conversation. And he says, Chris, how can we put money into streets and sidewalks when our buildings are literally falling down? We got to fix those first. Well, 2008 was a hard time in this community, or in this country, right? You had the whole mortgage fallout. We benefited because our real estate prices were already rock bottom. So there wasn't anywhere to go. But there was a lot of those stimulus dollars that came out. And so we applied for a couple grants. And one of them was a community development block grant. And another one was an iJobs grant, which is a state of Iowa thing. And I think the total amount was about $1.8 million that we received in grants. And what we did was we repaired the facades on 28 buildings around the square, and we fixed the structure on 6 buildings. And we also spent some money on that beautiful courthouse I mentioned. It changed things. There was local investment, right? People paid attention. We had people stopping and saying, what's going on? How do I become a part of this? And we began to see some of our buildings have new businesses. There was 15 years ago, you could have bought almost any building on the square for somewhere in the neighborhood between $15,000 and $25,000. It's for a two-story, standard-sized brick building. Today, I think it'd be difficult to find one for less than $80,000. So, not huge. I mean, $80,000 somewhere else is a lot. It's not very much, but in our community, it's a big jump. One of the next things that we did was we applied for another grant to address upper-story housing, right? So there were a lot of those buildings that now we've got the outside looking great, but the inside stunk. And particularly that second floor hadn't been used. It used to be that in a town like Bloomfield, the shop owner worked downstairs, lived upstairs. We didn't have the requirements that we do today for our standard of living, right? And so we got some money, and we're right now in the process. I think it was about $3 million that we received in grants for that. To work on those upper story housing, we're going to have a number of new units. And I think by the time we're done next January, we'll have about 160 people living on the square. It'll be the highest density of population in our entire county, right? And I lived on the square for a while. I'll tell you what happens when you live on the square. It's hard to park. It's really hard to park. There's no place to do it. So when you want to go to the grocery store, it's a lot easier to walk a half block down to the local grocery store than it is to hop in your vehicle and drive to Walmart 20 miles away, right? It's a lot easier to walk down and go a half block around to a restaurant. It injects money back into the community. And it's not through a buy local campaign. It's just easier. So we've had some success in bringing some outside dollars to our community. And it's you know, we're about 10 years later. 2013, the city clerk comes up to me and she says, hey, Chris, remember that streetscape idea that we talked about 9 years back? It's time to work on it again. And I wasn't very enthused. I wasn't ready, to be honest. So part of my story, just a little bit, I'm sorry to segue here, but you got to know just a little bit about me. I studied forestry at Iowa State University, and then I graduated and I chased a girl to the East Coast, and I ended up working in computers for the last 20 years. In 2009, let me back up. In 2000, my wife said, you know, we need to move back towards your family. You were having kids. They need to be near their grandparents. I wasn't so sure. I liked where we lived, but she convinced me. And it took about 3 months of convincing, and then one day I said, okay, let's move. And we literally spent a week. We packed up the moving van, got in the car, and I was calling people on the way to Iowa to figure out which town I was going to live in and in which house. So I can be a little spontaneous. But I also trust that somehow it's all going to work out. But the marriage didn't. In 2009, we split up, and I was, any of you ever gone through a big life-changing event in a small town? I mean, you want to run away. People look at you different. They assume things. But both my ex-wife and I live in the community, and we had 3 kids together, and it was very important to me that we tried to have as much family as you could. So we both stayed in town. And after, I guess, when the city clerk came to me and said, "Are you time to? It's time to work on the streetscape again." I'd kind of ducked out of volunteering for a couple years, trying to regroup, and she kind of had to twist my arm. But I finally agreed. But I said, "There's one thing I want to do." I'd heard about this community called West Union. It's another little town in Iowa, and they'd done a streetscape, and they did what I thought was just the coolest thing. When they tore up their streets, they put in ground source heat pump sinks, heat sinks in the streets, right? And they connected, or maybe they did it in the square, but anyway, right along there, when they tore it all up, they said, "We're going to put these wells in, and we're going to service these businesses." And I said to the clerk, "If I'm going to do this, we're going to try something like that." She said, "You're nuts. They didn't pass it the first time when you were just doing streets and sidewalks. There's no way they're going to want to pay for ground source heat pump stuff." I said, "Well, that's the deal. Take it or leave it." She said, "All right, go for it." So I got a group together. There's a small group that formed. And we put out a request for qualifications, which I recommend. So a lot of people, when you start a project like this, one of the things you'll do is put out a request for proposals. Our first step, we did the qualifications because we knew we didn't have a clue what we were talking about. And we wanted to find out if the people that were going to send us proposals knew what they were talking about. I think we got six responses to our request for qualifications. We sorted through them. We invited three to submit to respond to our request for proposals. Anybody could have submitted to our RFP, but we specifically invited these three companies. And two of them were very traditional. We'll do your streets, we'll do your sidewalks, we'll make them look fantastic. Don't get me wrong, they would have been gorgeous. But one of the companies, it was a pair of companies out of Des Moines and Chicago, actually. They came in and they said, "This is our vision." Well, they had our attention right away because they weren't just talking about replacing pavement. They said, "We're going to transform your community. We're going to help make it more energy efficient." When we were talking about energy, and I was thinking like ground source heat pumps, but they said, "You know, we're going to look at the water. We're going to look at electricity. We're going to look at gas. We're going to figure out how do we tie all of this together." I'm thinking, this is a streetscape, but it worked. And so it was one of the best decisions we could have made was to pick the right architect. If there's one thing that I could tell you to do when you're in the planning stage is don't go cheap. Pay the extra for the people that have the vision. Pay the extra for the people that are going to be innovative. It'll cost you. But when we hired them, immediately they had a relationship with state funders. And it wasn't that they said, "Here's this town, you state funders put money in," but they knew what the state funders were interested in, right? And so if somebody's going to give you money, if you're going to get grant money to build your community, you have to know what it is that people want to pay grants for. So finding the right professionals that are dialed into that makes a difference. So we hired these guys, and they started going through the same process that we'd gone through 10 years earlier, group meetings and those kinds of things. But they had a way of communicating that changed everything. When they started talking about, we can transform how the paving works. When they started talking about, we can change your heat source, it was amazing. People perked up. The city clerk was blown away. She thought there was no way that you were going to find a couple in their 70s that would care at all about whether or not there was heat pump well, or you know, ground source heat pump, you know what I'm saying, under the sidewalks. But it was what ignited the energy in our community. It was our first discussion about how do we transform the way that we use and produce energy when we started talking about sidewalks. It got the attention of this guy named Jeff Geertz, who works for the Iowa Economic Development Authority. Jeff started coming down and visiting our community, came to some of these discussions, and he pulled the city clerk aside one day and he told her, "You know, I've got this grant money that I'd like to put towards one or two communities in the state that might be able to go energy independent. There's this Iowa Association for Municipal Utilities. And he said, I want to give them some money to evaluate your community and one other community, and we'll see just how possible it would be for either one of you to go energy independent. So they did the study, and there was kind of this hint or promise that one of these two communities was going to, this was like a testing test, and one of them was going to get more funding to work on some of these projects. We did the study. The Iowa Association of Municipal Utilities said, yeah, you can do it. You could be energy independent. And they laid out a plan. They've got about an 88-page report. If you want a copy, let me know. I'll find a way to email it to you. They said, you know, the first thing you need to do is energy efficiency. Does that surprise anybody? They said you could save 25% of your electric bill if you just improved your, if you did the top 10 things in terms of energy efficiency. And they've got a list of 80 different things that we should be working on. And they went through it point by point. Here's the things you should do in terms of, you know, change your light bulbs, there's water issues, insulation, basic housekeeping things, to more extensive things where they talked about how do you sync water heaters or you know, do some community-wide planning so that not everybody's air conditioner turns on at the same time. There are some ways you can implement some controls and allow people to voluntarily sign up so that not everybody's air conditioner kicks on at 4 p.m. and you're paying for all that high electricity. So they recommended some ideas, and I went back to Jeff and I said, so how are you going to decide which community you're going to continue to work with? Which one are you going to fund? He says, I'm not. What do you mean? He says, well, you guys will figure that out. What do you mean? He says, well, one of you is going to start doing something, and then we'll help. Okay. We started. And they've been a big help. They've been a really big help. Expertise-wise, they've been a big help. I wasn't a big fan of state agencies, right? But I have to tell you that this group has been incredible. They've lent expertise. They've helped prepare grants. They've helped with research. If you aren't connected with your state groups, talk to them. They're really, early. I can't speak for Illinois, but in Iowa, they're accessible. You gotta work your way in, but they can be very accessible. So now we have this energy independence study, and we know we can do it. But how, right? It takes planning, it takes effort, it takes people on the ground doing things. And Jeff says, well, there's a couple things you should think about. One of them is, I think we could get you 5 or 6 or 7 people to come down through AmeriCorps and do energy efficiency in your homes. Okay, how much is it gonna cost? Well, you know, it's AmeriCorps, they'll just come down. Do any of you know about AmeriCorps? Okay, let me tell you from the administration side, it's not quite that simple. But we'll get into that in a second. So Jeff says, here, I've started this application, finish it, and then submit it. And so we applied through Operation AmeriCorps. It was a brand new program last year that, or I guess it's this year. This is the first year of existence. They selected 10 communities in the United States, and I think there was, I don't even know that they've released all of them yet, but we're talking about Detroit, I think, and New York, and LA, and Bloomfield. New York, I think they got 150 AmeriCorps workers, and we've got 8, but 8's enough. I stole that, right? 8 is enough. It took a lot of effort. I mean, the application for this Operation AmeriCorps was about 30 pages. We had to do a pre-app, submitted the pre-app, and then sometime in late January or February, they said, hey, you've been selected to move on from the pre-app stage to the final app stage. And at that point, we knew that they had selected, I think, 12 apps to go from pre-app to final app, and we knew they were going to fund 10, so we had a pretty good shot. So we worked on the application, and the idea was that we would bring in five AmeriCorps state workers that would go house to house doing energy efficiency audits and putting in energy efficiency measures. We'd get three AmeriCorps Vista people that would come in, and one of them works on volunteer engagement, one of them works on green jobs development, and one of them is working on coordinating energy efficiency throughout the community. At the same time, Jeff's one of these guys that you get about 10 emails from him a day. Hey, you should think about this. Hey, you should think about this. And it just gets overwhelming. Particularly at that time, I had a job, right? And so they come in so fast and so frequent and so many good ideas, it's hard to know which ones to pick up. And at the same time, so we know we've got this energy efficiency study. I also happened to sell for a solar installation company. And I had this deal in the city. I wasn't yet working for the city. I had this deal in the city, and it was a big deal to me. And went to the city council, and our understanding of the policy was that that the city had net metering. And net metering, if you don't know, it just simply means that when you produce electricity, basically you get to bank it and use it back when you need it, right? Well, the Public Works Director said, no, that's not what that says. It seemed very clear to us, but we'd sold it to the customer on the basis of that net metering existed. I mean, we were to the point where he'd cut the check and was ready to roll, took it to the city council for approval, and it was a big shouting match. It didn't go well, and they didn't approve it. They didn't say that they had net metering. It was really disappointing. So here I am working on this. We've got this energy independence study. We're working on an application for AmeriCorps to do energy efficiency. We're trying to be gung-ho with energy, and the city council denies our first solar project. And it took me back about 10 years when we were talking about streetscape, right? And the city clerk was ticked. She didn't understand what was going on. And about that time, one of the city council members that had voted no on the whole solar project says, somehow there was a conversation where she mentioned that we had all these emails from this Jeff Geertz, and he says, well, send them to me. I'm going to figure this out. She says, all right, fine. So she sends him just a blast of emails, and he sends one back and says, you need to apply for this. And she's like, okay. And so she writes off this really quick email, and she was just furious and sends this email and sends it out. And it went to the Rocky Mountain Institute, and that was how we got invited to go to the eLab Accelerator, which was, again, 12 communities from the United States, and San Diego, and Juneau, and, we were the tiny guys there, but it was the most fascinating experience. So before we got to, we go through this process, we're applying for AmeriCorps, we got the Energy Independence Study, we are applying to go to the eLab Accelerator, and we find out before we go to the eLab Accelerator that we've been awarded this Operation AmeriCorps grant. And the city guys are like, we need somebody to run this program. And I had written the grant in combination with this Jeff Geertz. And I said, Chris, would you, the clerk saying, Chris, will you do this? Would you be willing to quit your job, step into this role, and help us make this happen? I was excited. Actually, I was thrilled. I actually took a pay cut in order to do it. And I thought it was all a done deal. We were going out to the eLab Accelerator. No problem. I'll come back. I step into the role. We had some meetings beforehand. I thought I was going to be hired before we went to the accelerator. Turns out, it's never simple, right? A couple of city council members had some reservations because of the whole solar fiasco. They thought, oh, he just wants to step into this role so he can push solar and make more money. And a former city employee applied, and we went to church with one of the city council members. It just got sticky. So we went out to this eLab accelerator. I didn't really know. That was all happening in the background. I didn't know all of that had happened. We go out to the eLab Accelerator, and there are six of us that are going from the community. And we get out there, and the opening session is, so this is not a conference, it's more of a workshop. And the opening session, these two guys say, we're really skilled at helping people work through conflict, for helping teams identify why they have conflict and how do you get past it. And all of us on our team, we're looking at each other and we're saying, it's not us. No issue. Wow. We didn't have a clue. Within an hour, we were yelling at each other. Right? And it turns out, I didn't know this, the city council member that went with this, which wasn't the one that was irritated with me, but he was really suspicious of me too. And so that accelerator did a number of things. It helped us to clarify what we meant when we said we were going to head towards energy independence. It helped us to set some very specific goals that we could work on for the next year. It helped us figure out how do we talk about it with our community members. And most importantly, that whole conflict resolution and how to work, it was really important. So what's my point there? I guess what I'm saying is you got to listen, even when you think you know better, right? I mean, we were all dead certain we didn't need that conflict resolution assistance, but it turned out to be the key thing to make our community take the next steps. We came back, that city council member now had a better understanding of who I was. We built a bond, they hired me, and we've been moving forward. So that's about 41 minutes of history, I'm sorry. I want to tell you a little bit about what we're doing, and also want to take questions. And again, feel free to ask questions at any time. So some of the things that we've done include, sorry, one moment. So the AmeriCorps people began 3 weeks ago, and so we now have people in town that are planning and working on it, and we'll have five more AmeriCorps people that'll be in town in about 3 weeks. It'll start going door to door. Our goal is to figure out how in the next 2 years to go into two-thirds of the homes in our community and do energy. Yes, sir. There is a small industrial park outside of town, but mostly it's we are about 5 to 6 blocks in each direction, around the square. It's a fairly symmetrical community, about a little over a mile each direction, roughly. And so we have about, did I say 1,200 homes? So there's 1,200 homes in town, and we're trying to hit 2/3 of them in the next 2 years. Half of those we want to go back into and do some energy efficiency stuff, whether it's insulation or window caulking or changing light bulbs. We don't quite have the full menu figured out, but the goal is to get back into half of them. At the same time, we've now finished an audit of all of our city-owned properties and have begun to, so we went through, had someone come in, do a complete audit of all the buildings, identify where we're wasting energy, and then they've put together a menu that basically says, if you do this, it costs this much, and you'll have it repaid within so long. And we've begun to start ticking off those one-year paybacks. We have that solar. I didn't push it. The city reversed their opinion. They decided, I should mention that Bloomfield, the city of Bloomfield owns all of the utilities. We operate all the utilities in the community. So it's electricity, natural gas, water, and sewer and garbage. And so we're a little unique in that, if you're our neighbors outside are a rural electric cooperative, when you talk about net metering with them, it's a little different because their only source of income is electricity. We have taxes and multiple revenue streams. So, yes, sir. They are. Yeah. It's not something we brag about because, it's basically a tax, right? And so if we're collecting more than what costs, then we don't want to do too much of that, I guess, is what I'm trying to say.
Do they buy wholesale power and their gas?
We buy all. I'm sorry, thank you. Okay, so the question, two questions were, are the utilities profitable? And the answer is yes. Second question was, Do we buy wholesale all of our electricity and gas? And the answer, again, is yes. At the moment, we buy all of our electricity from the neighboring rural electric cooperative, and we buy our natural gas on the market. In September, we will be switching from our own water source to a rural water source. So we've made that switch. We're unable to keep up with regulations and requirements on the water side of things. How do we take that? Those profits, as you say, they've gone to fund other things. Sometimes when we need to, they fill in a street, they pay for this or that. And so one of the real concerns is, if we start doing energy efficiency, let's say we hit that goal of 25%, we're shrinking our profit, we're damaging our ability to do streets. You know, and let's say I sell you only half as much electricity, I still have to have the wire going to your house, right? So that's a real issue. And when you start talking about solar and net metering, you're essentially saying we're giving you that wire for free. So it's not a real good business model long term. But for us, I guess the way that we look at it is we have one solar array in our community right now. We're getting some attention for moving towards energy independence, and we have one solar array. They don't match up. And so we figure we need to be aggressive in our approach to try to really get some solar in town. But our intention over the next 15 years is to get to the point where we're producing all of our own electricity. We do. They may not all be renewable. We're working on that. We have 6 generators that we can run right now under emergency situations. So we have 3 gas and 3 natural gas and 3 diesel generators. And they will, over the course of the next year, come up to code so that they could be able to run any time. We just signed a new electric contract with our wholesale provider there were a couple really significant changes. One, we got a price decrease, which, I mean, who gets a price decrease in electricity right now, right? And we were prohibited from generating any power. Now we can generate power. We're allowed to do any renewable generation, right? And then we sold the rights to the generators, the gas and the diesel generators, to the cooperative so that they can sell it on the market. We won't have to fire them up probably rarely, but at least they have the option. We're looking at a solar array. So some of the things that we're talking about right now. Oh, and we've done some commercial lighting rebates, which has been huge for us. We're seeing a tremendous adoption of movement from old fluorescent bulbs to LEDs. Businesses are thrilled to be able to do that. So if you're working in a small community, it's amazing how fast the word gets out. We've done no publicizing of it. We haven't talked about it. And every day somebody stops me, says, how can I get involved with the rebates on LEDs? You say it's ComEd?
ComEd.
Okay, ComEd. So the comment was that ComEd is working with Ace Hardware or maybe other retailers?
Ace Hardware is the main one
That's where I drive my CFLs. So that you can get discounts on your CFLs and get them at the same price as an incandescent bulb? That's cool. We're looking at on-bill financing programs. So a little bit about that says, let's say you're a homeowner, but you don't have the $5,000 it takes or the $10,000 it takes to replace your heating and air conditioning system. But you know that if it's replaced, you're going to see huge increases in efficiency and you're going to save money. The city is putting together a program where we'll loan you the money at virtually no interest and help you to replace that. There'll be some conditions in terms of you have to use a qualified installer and all of that. But it'll let people that don't have the capital on hand and don't want to use their bank credit to go and make some improvements. So that's another thing we're working on. We are looking at a large solar array. We're hoping to put in about a 2-megawatt array within the next year, which for us would supply somewhere between 8 and 10% of our current electric needs. If you have a few extra million you want to spend, let me know. We are also looking at, I talked about around the square and when we do the streetscape, putting in geothermal heat sinks. We're looking at other options. Any of you know about ground source heat pumps much? I mean, some of the things we're talking about is using our former water supply as a heat sink. The lake on the east side of, or the west side of town, we're looking at, is there a way that you can use water and sewer mains as a heat sink? So we're exploring those kinds of things. We have some of the other things that are more long range. We have a lot of hog farms in our area. Iowa is one of the largest hog producers in the world, and our neighborhood has its share. And so we're looking at anaerobic digestion to produce methane. Perhaps we can clean that methane and use it as a natural gas substitute. You know, if we can move from, I mean, our goal is to figure out how can we produce all of our energy locally. We're beginning to figure out how to do it with electricity, but so some of the things we're talking about is how do you do fuel switching, right? So how do we get, I mean, that's one of the great things about the ground source heat pumps. You're switching people potentially from natural gas to electric in terms of their fuel source, and we can produce electricity. We also are looking at, the school system is actively looking at switching from diesel in their school buses to compressed natural gas. Yes,
chasing a fly.
Oh, okay. Sorry about that. You know, that's kind of a grand vision. So let's get switched to compressed natural gas. Let's figure out how to put anaerobic digesters that are cost effective on these hog farms. And then we can produce methane and run our school buses off of pig poop. There's a few other, yes, sir.
The school board is separate. You've got the city council. Is the city council really over all of this politically?
No. So the question is, the school board is separate. Does the city council have any direction in terms of where the school board goes? So the answer is no. People are excited. They want to get involved. And one of my role is really not technical. My role is, how do I get the word out? How do I put some initiatives in place? And how do we bring people together? I mentioned that the city councilman that sent the email and then we went to the e-lab. About a month after I got hired and we'd come back from the e-lab, I remember hearing him say, well, if it wasn't for me, we wouldn't be doing energy independence, because he sent that email. And I remember the city clerk saying, if it wasn't for me, we wouldn't be doing energy independence, because I'm the one that sent the email to Rocky Mountain National Institute. And I got to tell you, I was thinking, if it wasn't for me, I don't know why it took so long, but it took about 6 weeks before I realized, you know what? We're all right. All of us were right. It took every one of us. And I don't know, somehow that opened up my eyes a little bit. And there were people that, you know, I wouldn't say I disliked them, but I didn't actively try to involve them. Because I didn't necessarily care for their ideas, or I didn't think they were progressive enough, or whatever. And partly out of necessity, there's a whole lot to get done, and I can't do it all. And partly out of a little bit of humility finally hitting me, I realized we've got to try to engage everybody. It can't be this kind of deal where, you know, I'm the hero and follow me. It doesn't work. In fact, most of it I don't know, and so if they were following me, we'd end up lost. Yes?
Okay, so you've got a lot of balls in the air. What's the structure for keeping those balls and moving along, not being individual?
Oh, there's a lot of, the question is, there's a lot of balls in the air. How do we keep moving along and keep the balls from banging into each other? And I'm a ball, by the way. My name's Chris Ball. So I'm just to say, there's a lot of banging into each other. But one of the things we learned in that at Rocky Mountain Institute was how to begin to deal with conflict, right? And it was interesting because their position was that conflict is necessary. If everybody's getting along, you're not pushing hard enough, right? But if conflict is constant, then you're holding yourself back as well. So they described it as an ebb and flow. You got to have some points where it gets a little heated, and then you back off and you bring it back down, and it's this ebb and flow. And so it's okay. It's okay if the balls bang into one another every once in a while, because that keeps the conversation going and it brings new ideas to the table. It's all new. We're doing all these new things, and nobody knows how to solve it all, so we got to listen. Got to listen. Yes, sir. Yes.
So, you know, obviously they're going to come up with lists of things for homeowners to do, the different paybacks and stuff like that.
Sure.
So, but then, will there be extra resources coming behind that, or are you just going to leave that to the homeowners and say, okay, you get funds on your own?
Right. So,
do some loan stuff, or what are you going to do?
Yeah, so the question is, after the AmeriCorps members come through and they do an energy audit on your house, what next, right? Are there any resources to help us help the homeowner get those energy efficiency measures implemented? And right now the way we're looking at it is, if you are of a qualifying income, so we'll work, those AmeriCorps members will go back and perform some level, we haven't determined yet, some level of energy efficiency on any home. If you can afford it, we want you to pay for it. If you can't afford it, we've got some resources to do some very basic things. So we really want to help everyone, but if you can afford to pay for it, we want you to kick in so we can do more. Additionally, I mentioned the on-bill financing program. We hope to get that. I'm hoping that we'll see that go live within the next 3 to 4 months, so that at least if you're paying your bill, and I think generally the way this is going to work, if you're paying your bill regularly and on time, then your credit's going to be good enough. And we've looked at several models around the country, and generally, if people are paying their bills, they'll continue to pay their bills. Yes, sir?
So your thought that the bill will be reduced because of the investment, is the original amount differential going to be used to pay back?
Yeah, so the question is, how do we pay back that, how does the homeowner pay back that loan for the on-bill financing? And exactly right, the goal, although we aren't guaranteeing it, but the goal is that we will make your home more comfortable, right? And we hope to reduce the cost of making, of heating and cooling your home and running it to the point where that gap between what you were paying and what you're now paying will pay back that loan in about 5 to 7 years. Now, we're not guaranteeing it, but the goal is to try to hit that same constant. Now, yes, sir?
You know, as the auditors go through, they're obviously going to find, like this gentleman said, different paybacks. Oftentimes the things that, you know, where you can pay back in a year or, you know, 2 years, all right, that are also the cheapest, obviously.
Right.
Okay, and sometimes they'll produce the more immediate and larger savings. But, you know, if you could structure these loans so that that payback then goes into something that they couldn't afford before with a bit longer payback, like, for example, a new furnace. You know, you can't, you know, start out with a new furnace, but you can use these savings to then go to restructure, you know, the loan to go into a new furnace, you know, that's 90 or 95% efficient. And, you know, that way you will be able to bring these homes up to a much, you know, higher level of efficiency than you would, you know, if you just stopped, you know, with the basic, you know.
Yeah, so I think the discussion is about, we should target going for some larger measures with the on-bill financing, such as furnaces and HVAC and that kind of thing, and that's our intention. I think at this point the city council is prepared to set aside about $500,000 to guarantee these loans. So that's significant. You know, in our community, that'll probably do 50 homes at, and I don't know how we're going to find the workers to get 50 homes done, frankly. So. We're getting close to time, so I'll take another question, and then if you have further things, I'd be happy to step outside and visit with anyone. Yes, sir?
To go along, you've been talking about existing structures, existing businesses. Are you planning or have in code, if you're building a brand new development, you're putting in a brand new business, this is what you're going to need to do?
Right, so the question is, are we developing code to promote energy efficiency with new structures? And we're in that process. I suspect it's going to be a little while before we get that completed, but yeah, we are working on it. And we've got some new structures going up, so we're trying to talk with them even before we have the code in place. So, I guess we better wrap up, but thank you very much. And if anyone has any other questions, happy to visit.
Thank you.
Thank you.